everyone, and welcome to Dream Leapers with Harriette Cole. You know, I'm always excited to bring you very special guests, and today is a really special day. I have with us today an actress who's been out there for a long time, making us laugh, making us cry, making us enjoy the art form of acting. She is Tamala Jones. She's an NAACP award-winning actress. Now, you might remember her from Booty Call, from The Wood, For Your Love, Castle, and just last year, I believe, Every Breath She Takes, a Lifetime film. I love Lifetime films that she starred in and executive produced. Well, we're going to be talking to her about her career and her most recent film that opened just yesterday. It's called Ordinary Angels, and I'm still crying. That's what I want to tell you. The story is based on an actual family who went through a series of crises and survived thanks to friendship and love. Please join me right now in welcoming Tamala Jones.
Hello. That was beautiful. Thank you.
Oh, I've been following you for a long time, and so it is an honor to be here with you today. And congratulations.
Thank you so much. It's an honor to be here, and I love you. So this is amazing.
Oh, thank you. You know, where our paths first crossed was when I was at Essence, which is many, many, many moons ago. And just to see you as a strong Black woman of courage and dignity building your career, you know, it's just a nice thing to see.
Thank you.
And this film, so I just watched it. I was like, how much crying am I going to do? It's like, it's good tears, it's sad tears, it's frustrated tears. You know, a film is good when it draws upon your heartstrings and just takes you on this incredible journey. What made you decide to do this film, Ordinary Angels?
I had several good reasons. One, I loved the way the script flowed. It was a beautifully written. Kelly and Meg Tilly, they did a doozy. And I love that it was women who wrote it. That was the first attraction. Then I saw that Kingdom Story Company is doing it. And I love they do a lot of faith-based movies that don't make you feel like that's what you're watching.
Yes.
It gets the message across. So I always wanted to be in business with them. And John Gunn, I love the way he tells stories. But then they told me Hilary Swank was on there. And I said, wait a minute, Million Dollar Baby Hilary Swank. Nah, boys don't cry, Hilary Swank.
I'm right.
You don't have to beg me. I'm in. So, I mean, there was beautiful reasons why, but I definitely was looking forward to doing some scenes with Hilary.
And, you know, I totally agree with you about some faith-based films feel like they're hitting you over the head, you know, Bible thumping or, you know, that it just feels more than you want to see. This one, I think whatever your faith practice is, you can connect to this film. You really feel the humanity and you know, that humanity and faith conquer all. And don't we need that message now?
Oh, more than ever. More than ever, we need that message. So many great messages throughout this movie. The need for humanity and you know, loving thy neighbor, a sense of community, strengthening your faith and your hope, you know, and at the perfect time, because we've all been through something so traumatic, the pandemic, and none of us have ever been through that in our lifetime. We all went through it together, and it was traumatizing. And I think people got drawn in and like in a protective bubble and not wanting to reach out and help because it did feel like the end of the world at some point.
Well, and it was for some people.
Yeah, it really was. And I think we're all wounded. Mm-hmm. And some people are afraid to ask for help because it just, you feel helpless. And some people don't know how to ask or so into, I'll figure it out myself. No one can do anything alone. We all need one another. And this film has a great message of that.
I love the story of friendship and your character, because you play Hilary Swank's best friend and shop co-owner. And I absolutely love seeing you two together and the way that you have unconditional love for her. You know, it's not a giveaway to tell a bit of the story. You know, Hillary Swank is a troubled character who drinks too much, right? Mm-hmm. And this scene when she goes over the top drinking and you as a best friend, you don't judge her, but you can see the pain and the worry that you have for your friend. Most of us have had friendships where somebody goes way too far and, you know, the best friend tries to reel them back in. And it's such a difficult thing to do. I appreciated the way that you played your role. Can you talk about really inhabiting that friend and what you hope to convey?
I hope to convey that we learn from one another. No matter if that person is in a negative position or if you're in a negative position, we learn from one another. Rose, I pulled every resource from my grandmother's energy, from what my grandmother gave. My grandmother was a no-nonsense. She didn't judge you. She was welcoming. There was never a stranger that she met. That's what Rose I tried to give Rose in that. And yeah, Sharon, she had a drinking problem, but her heart was so content on helping this baby that she made me understand me as a person and Rose as a character at that very moment. Yeah, we all got issues. We all have things that we need to tend to and we must do that. But life isn't just about us. It's about the impact that we make on others. Mm-hmm. So I hope people understand that too.
And we see, as you mentioned, there are lots of lessons in the film. There are lots of things that we can look at, regardless of whether this is our situation, whatever the circumstances of the film, you can see yourself and relationships reflected in it. And forgiveness and love are huge, huge.
Forgiveness and love. That those two things, we need so much more of that right now. Forgiveness and love, because life is so short. You're angry or you're harping or you're holding grudges on things that really don't matter at the end of the day, you know, and forgiveness for yourself. Forgive yourself so that you can forgive others. Love yourself so you can love others. Do that for yourself. Mm-hmm. Once you start loving on yourself and forgiving yourself, because everybody comes here with mud on them, you know, we have to, like the lotus flower, we have to blossom from that mud. It doesn't matter where you come from. It matters where you end up. And a lot of that is forgiveness and love.
And there's a scene in the film. And by the way, I'm not going to say too many scenes, y'all, because you need to see this movie. It's just out. You need to go see it. But it's not a giveaway. This is something that we hear about a lot for people who are in 12-step programs. And one of the things that is talked about is, do something for somebody else when you're hurting. Because when you offer yourself in service to something other than you, perhaps something bigger than you, you can heal. And that's another thing that we see in this film, that the intent with which Hillary Swank's character goes for helping this little girl helps to bring her out of the mud. Right? Like sometimes it's got to be something bigger than you. And this ended up being that thing.
And that was another thing I loved about Hillary's character, Sharon. She did it. I mean, and she still was fighting her demons. But in helping this family, she still lost it. She went out and I hope I'm not telling you, because nothing's perfect. We're not perfect people at all. And we mess up, even if our intention is to do well. But she had a mirroring moment at that time. And that's something I think people will be able to identify too.
Because it's real.
It's real.
This movie is very real. It's not a fairy tale. It's real. I mean, it's amazing. The story is the story of miracles. Yes. But it's real. And I think that's why, like I said, I had many tears. And so for you as an actress, I'm just curious about the process, because your job is to invoke that emotion in your audience. What is your process in being able to activate that within us without you just breaking down and crying yourself?
Well, a wonderful actress taught me a long time ago, Miss Jennifer Lewis, that if you don't believe the words that are coming out your mouth, nobody else will. So when I prep for anything, whether it be funny or serious, I make sure that it sounds authentic, that I believe that I would say that or I'm saying that, so that the audience can believe. That is the preparation for any character, I think, that I do, that I be as real as possible, that I be someone that you know, or I'm you, you know?
Mm-hmm. And you certainly do that well. So my show is Dreamleapers. It's all about helping people to access and activate their dreams. And so I like to talk to my guests about how it all started. When did you know? In this business, what was that thing that activated it for you?
To let my mom tell it, I came out the womb acting. Let her tell it. But I believe it was when I was 7 or 8. My grandmother, my mom, and my aunties, we all got dressed up and went to go see Dreamgirls. Ooh. And I saw these beautiful women that look like me on stage being superstars and singing and being sassy, you know? And I started coming home, you know, with the shoulders and the head movement. And of course, watching Good Times, I thought I was Penny. And then Debbie Allen, I did the opening of Fame every day in the backyard, the split jump. And then I had to tell everybody, you want fame? Well, fame costs, you know. But that dream became a reality for me, I would say, in the sixth grade. Mm-hmm. Lark Voorhees, who was on Saved by the Bell, who I watched every Saturday morning, was in my class. I'm like, oh my God. So I asked her, you know, how do you do it? She was like, my mom got me into it. So I went home and told my mom, that's what I want to do. And my mom was like, yeah. You wanted piano lessons. You wanted a ballet. I was like, but this is it. So she didn't take me seriously because I was forever changing what I wanted to do. And then the following year, Jaleel White showed up at my school. And I'm like, Lisa and Urkel, if they're doing it, I can do it.
So what school were you attending?
So I went to John Marshall Fundamental in Pasadena. And I went from 6th through 12th grade. The school was based on a high academics. You had to have a certain grade point average to stay there. It was a public school, but there were rules, you know, no shorts, no skirts above your knees, and maintain a grade point average. So all the nerds went.
You imagine now, no shorts and no skirts above your knees.
Oh, honey, they would be like, I'm calling my mama now, you know. But yeah, so I was there and those kids came there. And then I got into drama class in school. And then my family had a catering business and they were doing weddings and stuff like that. And they met one guy, he was in production. He was like, you guys are so good. If I come across anything, I'm going to call you. And I can't remember his name, but I will it afterwards. He worked for Eddie Murphy. So he passed our name around and the caterers from House Party got fired. So they called my family and I wanted to go.
And that was a huge film. Wow.
Yeah. So I went and I met everyone. And I really was excited to meet Tisha Campbell because I had watched her on a ABC show where it was a bunch of girls. And I was like, oh my God. And then Little Shop of Horrors. So she's now on set and I'm asking her all these questions and she's so pretty and so nice. And her mom and my mom ended up chatting it up a bit and her mother told my mom how to get me involved properly. So it was Tisha Campbell's mother who got me started.
Isn't that something? And you just never know what those connections are going to be. Your parents have this catering company that gets you in the door to one of the biggest films of that year, right? I mean, House Party was huge and now it's iconic. And Tisha Campbell has turned out to be like one of your besties, right?
Oh my, I love Tisha. I love her so much. I have been stalking her since House Party. And I got a chance to, the thing that I executive produced for Lifetime, I asked her and she said yes. I was shocked that she even said yes. And she was like, it was a no-brainer, Tam. Of course I was coming to help you out. But I was
let's talk about Lifetime for a minute, because there are Lifetime devotees. I am one of them. It's just, you know, like you kind of hush hush and say how much you watch these, but they make some movies. And so what was it for you to say, okay, I'm going to do this movie. I'm going to EP this movie. Why that movie? And what is your relationship with the Lifetime movie craze?
So I also love Lifetime movies. I can binge watch Lifetime movies all day for days. So I'm a Lifetime movie junkie. I had already done a movie called Mega Church Murder years ago for Lifetime, and they really loved it. And so the person that produced that and wrote it was a writer that I worked with on For Your Love. His name is Sean Dwyer. And we did so good. Sean is always coming back to me with his partner, Elizabeth. And they said, hey, we got something. Lifetime wants to do it, but we think it's time for you to executive produce. And I was like, yes, it is.
Of course. So I love it when people see it in you, right? That is brilliant. A lot of times you have to claim it, but I love that that they saw it for you and offered that entree.
Yeah. And so they were like, now, you know what you got to do? You got to open up that Rolodex and call some of your friends. So Tisha was the first person I called. And then everybody else, you know, Brian White, it just got easier. Once you got Tisha on board, you know, everyone was like, yeah, I want to do it, you know? So it was a beautiful experience. It wasn't as hard as I thought it would be EPing. Because I'm the oldest sister and the only girl, so I already EP in the family anyway.
you had a real life experience, right?
Right. So I really enjoyed that.
Now, another thing, just in terms of, well, we're not going to call it coincidences, but these intersections, Hilary Swank figures into your life very early on too, right? In connection with, what was your story with her from the beginning?
No, I just was a big fan of hers. You know, I watched everything. And when I saw the first time I saw her in Boys Don't Cry, I just couldn't believe that a girl, a woman could be so diverse in a role like this.
Yes.
And really embody this girl having these issues.
Right. She's an incredible actress. And you know what? In my brain, I was not thinking of Hillary. What is the actress who you babysat, whose family ended up giving you acting lessons? That was a really interesting story.
Blake Lively.
Yeah.
My little Blakey. she was such a cute baby. Oh my goodness. She's a beautiful woman now, but adorable. Her parents were very instrumental in everything. They became my managers later, but they had a school of just working actors and actresses. Jamie Presley, Brittany Murphy, Seth Green, John Huertas, who I worked with on Castle, Joel Michaeli. Like, I worked Tara Reid. Like, everybody came out of this class. They had everybody working. And they taught me a lot about the business. They taught me, you know, your acting job starts when you get out of the car. You have to show up. Your energy has to be good. Nobody cares about your personal life. Keep that stuff to yourself. Know your lines. Be professional. Don't get too comfortable with anything. That is not your place. Your place is to know your lines, have good energy, and go home. That was it.
Be professional the whole way through. Now I saw your interview with Tamron Hall. So you and she were talking about this one. I loved the conversation, but you know, you are also proof that you don't have to give up if you don't have the money. So your parents could not afford to give you those classes, right? But right. You negotiated a way that you were still able to do it. What happened?
Well, my mother is the one who started out. My mother was like offered to clean their home and cook for them and do whatever it is, you know? And then she had her own things. So I was like, well, what can I do? You know what I mean? We both would help them. I couldn't cook at that time. Now I can, but you know, we would both help out with whatever. And they needed Blake to be babysat. So my job was to make sure I played with her and she had fun. she loved watching The Little Mermaid.
So you watched it 10,000 times. I love
it. A million times.
Just play it again, please, please, please.
She loved dancing and singing. Her favorite song was at the time was Rock the Cradle of Love by Billy Idol. Sassy little girl, adorable. But I babysat her to help pay for my acting classes. And I was very grateful that they allowed me to do that because it could have been a hard no and I would have had to find some other way. But it was all about doing whatever necessary to get what you need, you know? If you don't have money, you can work around it. People need things done.
Sure. What would you say has been the most fun project that you've worked on in your career?
I'm going to say Booty Call. Because that was my second movie. My first movie, I didn't even have a speaking role. And that was How to Make an American Quilt. I was just in a flashback scene. But having Booty Call in Living Color had just gone off the air. They were done shooting. I watched them every week. Jamie and Tommy and everybody. So now I get to work with them. And then Vivica, I watched her in Out All Night with Patti LaBelle and thought she was like this beautiful Black Barbie. Like, oh my God. And now I get to be with them. We had so much fun. We shot in Toronto. And at the time we were up there, Don Cheadle, Daryl Chill Mitchell, Eric LaSalle, these guys were all up there shooting a movie about a legendary basketball player, the GOAT. And right. So every weekend we'd be playing spades or, you know, hanging out or going to this club, this little Jamaican club, which was, I mean, the floor was vibrating. There was a party in there. And I was barely 21. So this was like exciting and I had so much fun. And it was all about laughter and me, you know, they would tell me, Jamie and Tommy would give me different jokes and different directions to do. And I would do it. And they'd be like, oh my God, you are hilarious. You know, I'm like, you guys told me to do it. I was just like.
Did you ever feel intimidated? I mean, they were huge stars and Living Color was so big. It was everything. That was a groundbreaking show. And for you as a 21-year-old, going on set with these folks, did it ever feel overwhelming?
Yeah, I was so nervous. My skin broke out.
Ooh.
I got the bubble guts before it was time to go down and rehearse. I was late because of that. And Jeff Pollock, God rest his soul, he's no longer with us. He was like, Tamala, you know, in this business, you need to be on time. I was like, I know. But in this business, you shouldn't mess your pants on the first day either. So once I said that, he was like, okay, that's it. I understand. The ice was broken and the ride began, you know? It was really nice.
What would you say has been the most challenging? That was the most fun. What role has been the most challenging for you?
The most challenging role, I would say, would have been Lainey. For Castle, playing the medical examiner. I had no one to teach me what the medical words were.
Ooh, that alone. You have to go to the dictionary and practice, right?
Practice. I'm glad that we have on, you know, Google, if you do the dictionary, you can also push to hear the pronunciation.
Yes.
I felt like I was in med school. And, you know, I didn't really know to do that in the beginning. I was just trying to learn everything on my own. And I was so nervous about saying it right. I just blew my lines. And this went on for first and second season. But once I got the delivery out, it was that. And then I heard third season that they were going to get rid of somebody.
Uh-oh.
So I got on it. I got that medical encyclopedia dictionary, and I got it down, you know. Having to learn those terminologies and say it like you know what you're talking about and not get hung up on the words, it was very, very challenging.
I'm so glad you mentioned that because, again, a lot of people don't know what that process is like on the inside of creating a production. And now there's so many medical shows and, you know, all those words we as viewers don't know if they're real or not, you know, but we hear them and, you know, you hear them enough times and you're assuming we're trusting the characters to own whatever that material is. And you're right. I mean, some of these are, they're Latin terms, they're terms that we don't know. Are there coaches on set for any of that stuff or you literally just, it's on you?
We didn't have, at the beginning, I would say there was no budget for a coach.
Sure.
So I was left to do that. I had, and it was not easy. And it was embarrassing for me because I don't like to hold anybody up. I don't like to do a bunch of takes. I like to get it done. If the takes that we do is because the director sees something and he wants to do more, I'd rather that be the reason.
Than it be you.
Than it be me. Yeah. Yeah.
Completely understood. Okay, so The Wood, which is a classic film, people love that film. You're remaking it, is that right?
We were doing a television show.
Okay.
Based on the movie with all new characters, all new cast members, but some of us veterans like myself and Richard T. Jones, and I believe there were more. I'm not really sure that came in. Some people were like on the fence because they were working. But we came in to help usher, you know, the new ones, and Showtime passed on it.
Oh.
But we're still, I believe Rick Famuyiwa is still out there shopping it. And if he's not, I'm going to get on him because no doesn't mean nothing to me. One person said no, somebody else will say yes.
Well, and we keep putting it out into the universe. I mean, people love The Wood.
They
it's
do.
One of those films that lives on. So to have a TV series is a lovely idea anyhow.
Yeah. And I was really excited because Melvin Gregg, who I'm a big fan of, he's really doing his thing right now. He's also in this new Wood television show and he was phenomenal in it.
So we're going to just hold it in our awareness that, you know, like your film, Ordinary Angels, it's going to be out in the universe and somebody's going to say, yes, we need that one. Let me remind folks, this is Dream Leapers with Harriette Cole. And we have the honor today of talking with Tamala Jones. You've known her over the years for many of her roles. Today's role is in this amazing film, Ordinary Angels, that just came out yesterday. So you need to go see this film right away. Tamala, you've had a career where it's been a consistent build, right? You've had a lot of interesting projects. And along the way, you also had a serious health scare.
Yes.
Can you tell us about that? Because, you know, people know, yes, we work hard. If we do a good job, we're going to get somewhere. Life gets in the way sometimes, and it certainly did for you. Please tell us what happened.
Well, at the tender age of 23, I had a brain aneurysm. I had headaches consistently for like 2 weeks, and they just kept getting stronger and stronger. I thought it was sinus because in my family, we always have sinus issues, sinus infections, you know, around this time of the year, it just really gets crazy. So I thought that's what it was. And I was taking sinus medicine. Nothing was working. And one morning I woke up, my head was like really hurting, felt like a rubber band was tied around my brain and was pulling. And I woke up having the urge to urinate. And when I got up, I had no balance. I was walking on my toes. I get to the bathroom. I plop down on the toilet. And nothing came out, but my head started hurting even worse. And when I got up, it's like I hit the floor. And I was there alone. I heard a voice telling me, get up, Tamala, get up now. So my angels were trying to get me up. Like, this is not the time. Yep. Mm-hmm. So I got up, and when I got up, I called my job, you know, and I was like, look, I can't come in. I don't know what's happening to me. When I got up off the ground, the whole right side of my body was numb and it was hurting. Like, everything still hurt. And now the brain felt cold. Like, it was cold. Ooh. And hurting. They said, just come in. We'll have a set doctor look at you. This is the last day of shooting. We got to finish this.
Oh, so awful. Oh
my God. But this is Hollywood.
This is Hollywood. Show must go on, right?
If you can walk and talk, get your butt in here and let's shoot this and we'll deal with that later. So I get in the car and, not putting two and two together, I just start everything up. I forgot I don't have any feeling on the right side. So I put my foot on the gas and I had to put my other foot, the left foot, on the brake and like lift my leg up off of the gas and drive with my left foot and my left hand to work. Mm-hmm. When I get there, my arm is stuck like in a position that, as if I'm offering you my arm to help you down the stairs or something.
It's just stuck.
I can't move it. I can't bend it. It's numb. And I'm hurting. So everybody's like, well, what's wrong with you? I'm like, I don't know. I don't know what's wrong with me. So they're putting jackets, they put purses, everything to like, they're like, you can't bend it. I'm like, I can't bend it. Even if they try to, it just hurt even more here in my head. So I worked all day and then I go to the hospital and
they hung bags on your arm or something to make it seem like there was a reason that it was up. That is so unbelievable, Tamala.
It worked out because after I saw the scene, it looked good. You couldn't tell anything was wrong with me. So it worked. But then, you know, after that full day, when I got there, the doctor didn't even know how I was still alive. He didn't even know how this was possible. I hemorrhaged, the aneurysm burst. Ooh. That was the reason why
usually when people die.
Yeah, that's what he said. So they tested me for every drug under the sun because they said usually someone your age, this would have to do with hard drugs. And I was like, I don't do hard drugs, you know, like that's. So they tested, they didn't find anything. They said, the other reason this could have happened to you is it's hereditary. Mm. And we found out it was. I had a cousin in Mississippi that had 13 aneurysms in a row after giving birth to her twins. They told her she would never walk or talk ever again. And she is. She cursing them kids out. But she slumped on the side that it happened.
13? So she's a walking miracle herself.
Yeah, she is.
How old were you when this occurred, Tamara?
23 years old.
23. And how long did it take? They had to do surgery to repair it, right?
I had no surgery to repair it. After the MRI, he saw, since it burst, he said, once this heals, once the blood dries up, you will get your healing back. He told my mom and my grandmother that I needed to go twice a week to a doctor to get shots of B12, B vitamins. I was also on medication. And we did that. And I don't even really remember much of anything at that time other than my mother or grandmother waking me up to take a bath or to make me eat or drink something. And I don't remember eating a lot, but I remember she made me drink the green tea, honey. I had to drink the green tea.
You had the green drink before we knew about green juice.
That's it. So I did that, and in 3 months I healed fully. And
you know,
I was
the miracle also of youth, right? You were that I'm sure helped you. So you had a 3 month pause in working and just in restoring yourself to health. Having had that experience, did it impact the way you take care of yourself?
Not at first. At first, I was angry that that happened to me. I was angry that I was young, that that happened to me, because I was ignorant. I didn't know that this thing is ageless. It happens to newborns, you know? But I was so upset. So I had like a little Tupac energy going on right now. I beat death. I'm alive. Leave me the hell alone, you know? But then I had a friend tap me and say, girl, I don't know what this is, but it's ugly. You need to stop that.
Oh, good. Thank God for that friend.
Thank God for that friend. And that's when I sat down and was like, all right, this happened and you don't want it to happen again. So then I got on this vitamin kick, you know, like, let me take my B12s. Let me find out where I can get another shot. I still get B12 shots to this day just to make sure that, you know, that that takes care of your whole nervous system and your brain is one big nerve, you know?
Interesting, because a lot of people of color suffer from vitamin B12 deficiency. So that's interesting that you have stuck with that. That's smart.
Yeah, the Bs are very important, and also magnesium. Hmm. If we keep the magnesium level balanced, we need 500 milligrams each day, the doctor said. So those are my things. If I don't take all my vitamins, I'm doing those for sure.
And so, you know, Hollywood is also the place where you're judged by how you look, how your body is. How has that been for you as a Black woman in this space? You know, there's so many conversations about the challenges that Black women face, and also just our bodies are not necessarily like those, you know, size 2 girls who, you know, and now the Ozempic girls.
Honey, it has been very challenging because I've gone up and down, up and down, up and down after my 20s. People don't understand. Like, I've been doing this since I was 14.
Exactly.
So you got a little 14-year-old body out of me. You got the 20-some-year-old body out of me. You watched me as I've gone, grown, you know? So then you got the 30-something body where everything starts spreading and feeling out. And I remember one time they were like, what's wrong with her? Is she pregnant? Is she depressed? Like, what's going on? It's nothing. It was just being a Black woman and me getting my curves. Everything hadn't balanced and figured itself out yet. It was just the thickness was coming. Mm-hmm. Also, I didn't know that I couldn't eat certain, you know, eat the way I'd always been eating. You got to change the way you eat. You know, certain things just don't work for you no more. And then exercise. I hate the gym. I do not like the gym. Anything outdoorsy that makes working out fun, I will do it. But then I was like, I don't have time. And then I was smoking cigarettes at one time. And I didn't want to go hiking because I couldn't breathe properly. So my friends would be like, let's go hiking. No, I ain't going. I don't want to go. But I've since quit smoking.
Good.
I love hiking. That's my...
You live in California, right? So it's a beautiful place to hike.
It is. I love swimming. Yeah. And I really love that I can breathe and take a deep breath in and not feel restricted. You know, you don't notice that when you're smoking. You don't notice that you're not breathing properly. You don't have your air.
Was it hard for you to stop?
No. I'm one of those people, when I say that's it, that's it. Mm-hmm. It's done.
For you.
If you tell me to do it, I'll be like, I am. Just wait. I'm never going to do it. But if I say that's enough, that's enough. That is enough. We're not doing that anymore.
What do you do for fun now? What do you do for you?
I play again. I've tapped into my inner child and I play. And I have my playmates, my friends, and we definitely go hiking. We go on vacation. We do karaoke. I love to karaoke and sing. People that think they don't have a great voice, you are my target. I want you to come up here and sing because we all need to shout sometimes, you know? It feels good. But if you shout in a positive way, then you're doing it right. You know what I mean? Right. That negativity, that'll make you or the person you're yelling at feel good at all, you know? But singing, I don't know. Even when I was little and had to go to church on Sunday, yeah, about your word, but let's get to the singing part. You know, I love the choir. I love how people felt. I love how it made me feel.
And it didn't matter if you had the voice. You don't have to be the soloist. You just need to get it out.
Sing, yes.
So I hear you're working on something with Tisha Campbell now. Tell us what's new. What's new, what's next?
So Tisha is on a show with Neil Patrick Harris, and it's called Uncoupled. And it's basically like the male version of Sex and the City. And she works at this agency, and there's this friend that they've been talking about who's rude, you know, and who went to this guru to like fix herself, but she's got a lot of sass, and I play that friend. Uh-huh. So my first time was last season, and when I got done, the producers were like, oh, we're bringing you back for sure. And now I will be back this season for a few episodes.
That's fun.
Yeah.
And you get to play with her on set.
Play with my girl.
That's nice. So you EP'd that Lifetime film. Do you see more of that in the future?
Yes, I will be doing more executive producing. I eventually will direct something too, but I like the executive producing. I'm very good at putting things together, you know, putting people together, putting a nice, I don't know, whatever it is you tell me to put together, I'm good at puzzles. I'll put it together and make it look really beautiful. And that's executive producing for me.
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, your film, Ordinary Angels, which is out right this minute in theaters right now, what do you hope that the viewers will walk away with? When they experience the film, what do you think will happen?
I really feel that they will walk away feeling much happier than they did when they walked in there. They will walk away very inspired to just be a little bit more kinder to one another, you know, and hopefully inspired to do just random acts of kindness to perfect strangers. You know, you become an ordinary angel. We all have the possibility to do it.
And it's a true story. This is the thing that is so amazing. So as we close out, let's play the trailer so everybody can just get a little sneak peek. Let's play it and watch it together.
Okay.
I'm just a ticked off hairdresser with a splitting headache.
I'm good at plenty of things. Taking no for an answer ain't one of them.
You just wandered into a lady you never met before's funeral. Why exactly?
Something about that little girl. She's just 5 and she already needs a liver transplant.
Hi, Sharon, remember me?
Yes, ma'am.
So she's gonna help out a few nights a week.
I met this woman. She's a mess.
Perfect, she'll fit right in.
I'm gonna put together a press kit for Michelle, get corporate donations, that kind of thing.
We don't need to be running around worrying about money and bills right now. I just want to be with my family.
Life's about saying yes and then figuring out how. Girls, help your daddy out.
I'm not comfortable with this. I'm her father. I'm supposed to be the one taking care of her.
You're going to have to get comfortable being uncomfortable because this ain't about you. It's about your little girl. When your insides
breaking in. Michelle will need to fly to the children's hospital immediately. I've had patients who have missed that window because they couldn't get a flight.
Don't lose your faith over this.
Officials are saying be prepared for what they're calling the worst blizzard in state history.
Is it today? Okay, we'll be there. You want to go on an adventure?
Yeah. Let's you go.
The roads haven't been plowed. The airport's closed. Honey, listen, it's too dangerous.
I have to make it. This is our last chance. If we don't take it, Michelle dies.
Someone's got to do something. Someone's got to fight for it.
So one thing I know for sure, that little girl now has the entire city rooting for her.
want you to know something. You're not just worthy, Sharon. You're a miracle.
Oh, man. I just want to tell folks, it is a treat. The story is so beautifully told. I want you to be my best friend when I'm watching that film. Like, oh, you play that best friend really, really well. It's such a sweet, loving movie. And I think there are messages for all of us in it. Congratulations.
Thank you so much. I hope that we all take messages from whatever message you can get. I hope you get one from this movie. It's all positive.
Yeah. Congratulations. Thank you for joining us. I know you have inspired my audience to leap into their dreams, just as you have been doing for so many years. Congratulations on this film. Everyone, go out and see it right now. It's in theaters right this minute. Thank you, Tamala Jones.
Thank you. God bless you.
And God bless you. And thank you, everyone, for tuning in to this episode of Dream Leapers. Until next time, have a great day and make it count. All right, we are with the starring actress of this incredible film that is so touching to the heart. What did you love the most about it?
I loved all of the whole emotional roller coaster. The dips of, oh my God, are they going to get it? They're not going to get it. Oh, they might get it. Like, it just took you through the truth of what happened, but I love the emotion it brought out in me. I watched this movie already, I don't know how many times, and it still gets me.
Do you cry every time?
Every time, in different sections. I'm just touched.
And it's all different kind of tears, right?
Yes.
It's not just one
tears of happiness, tears of joy. Mostly that, you know. There's a couple of times it gets sad, but it's like, I'm excited. I'm so happy that things are moving the way they are. It's just a very touching movie.
Congratulations. You did a beautiful job.
Thank you.